Yes, record. Okay, it's doing. Okay, small group, no problem, because it is an intermediate session, just organized because I had a number of people asking up front in Facebook to tell a little bit about Git and GitHub and start using Git or GitHub. The most easy thing, I've given this presentation about 2 years back in Spain. My idea was bring your own PC so you can do things while I'm busy. It's easy to work, but it's not that complicated. You will see the DNN Connect 2016. I gave that presentation together with one of my colleagues, John Capeman, who's not here today. So I'm doing this one for myself, and I'm going to repeat part of the total presentation that I gave at that time. This is a new slide, so this is the sponsors from this year. I'm doing a presentation. I'm going to specify a small number of parts in there. I'm not going to repeat everything which is in here because last time it took about 2 sessions and I want to compress it a bit and do 1 session for that one. My idea is that Git or GitHub, which is the open source repository, is available for everyone, for everything that you do, whether you write content, Word documents, Excel spreadsheets, whatever, you can use Git to your beneficent. But most of us use GitHub for as development. You do something and you want to store the source some way or the other. And for DNN, the most important part is that you want to use Git or GitHub or Git processing to contribute to software that has been developed by others. And those are the 3 things I'm going to discuss and explain a little bit in the next couple of 15 minutes. The other ones, managing contribution, you're a manager of a module or manager of part of DNN and you get all kinds of changes and enhancements from different people. How do you cope with that? And I have also a special session about how you can contribute to DNN platform itself, although it's a little bit changed because people are rethinking how issues, how problems should be stored. Nowadays it's in Jira, which is part of Evoke as well as DNN platform, and they think about separating those two issue systems, one of them in GitHub, which has a good issue tracking system, and for Evoke on Jira. So there's the thing that I leave out. And Git for documentation and Gitbook I leave out as well. So I'm going to discuss the first 3 things, GitHub for everybody, GitHub for a developer, and how do you contribute to other people. Okay, what you need in order to start working, if you do the whole session with the 6 subjects, you will need everything in there, but nowadays you only need an account on GitHub. You don't need Visual Studio for this part. It's just learning how the terminology works for Git and GitHub. I use SourceTree, which is a Windows application that helps extracting the things that you have changed, managing branches in your software, and preparing updates to other projects. And for example, Notepad. Now I'm going to use Notepad just to add and create some files and make some changes in that so you can see how this is handled by that. So you only need, if you want to do this, an account on GitHub, SourceTree, that is linked to GitHub if you want to, and Notepad. And if you really want to exercise, do the exercise, you work with 2 people together. Not going to do it today, but that's the idea behind it. I see a lot of pictures over the years that has something to do with the GitHub, and you see all kinds of terminology that is linked to GitHub, reset, hard, head, pushed, show must go on, and so forth, and so forth. But essentially, there are only, I think, 6 words that you have to understand in order to start working with Git and GitHub. It's not more complicated than that. That's why I tell GitHub is for everyone. The last time, why do you want to do Git? If you write code only once and your code is perfect and doesn't need any modification over time, if you are working for yourself and never in a team working together with others, you do not write documents, you do not need version of your, you keep a perfect backup and a log of all the updates that you change you make. If all these things are true, you have time to leave now. But I would like to interview later on to see, because you are a very unique person, maybe you want to work for me. Okay. Still sitting here. Yes, you are. So, what's the most important GitHub for? What's the most important question about GitHub? And why do people find Git or GitHub so difficult to start with? I don't know what kind of source management systems you used before. I used, I think, 6 or 7 different source version systems before, and most lately Team Foundation services to check in and check out sources. I've come across situations where people build zip files with a particular date in there and put it on a folder. That's their source repository. But the most difficult thing I found when I started with Git, and I think it was about 4 years back, it's that they use things the other way around, like driving on the left side of the road where you should drive on the right side of the road. And first of all, what I find strange, they are going forward, but their arrows are going left. That's the way how they draw these things. And they use new words. You have to get used to the new words: repository, fork, clone, commit, stage, branch, rebase, pull request, master head, whatever. People draw it the wrong way. Because it originated from Linux or Unix, most of it's command line based, which I like for MS-DOS, but not for the command prompt, but not so much for Git. That's the reason why I use SourceTree, which is a graphical interface around all these command lines. Why is TFS not enough? I will come later on. And another question is, I do not trust the merge, because the principle of Git is everybody can work on source, and Git or GitHub will merge all the differences that people create. That's a problem. If you are working for 1 month on one source file and another person is working on the same source file also for 1 month, and after a month you hope that these things will be merged together. That doesn't work, because it's no magic in there. It's just intelligent way of merging different things. So if you go later on and work with Git or GitHub — Git is the technology and GitHub is the website that is there — you're going to learn that everything that you changed must be small chunks. Build it as small as you can if it's consistent, and that's the smallest chunk you will add in. Will there be never a problem for two people working on the same one? Yes, there can be problems, and that's the merge problem. Every one out of, let's say, 25 merges, you have to do something, because different people have been working on the same part of the code and it doesn't work anymore. But the big advantage is that a lot of people can work at the same time on the same source or source files or different source files. Because if you work with small chunks, it's very easy to merge the different parts together. The benefit is everybody in the open source world uses Git or GitHub. It's excellent for distributed development, because you have a complete environment in your own PC. Your own working environment contains all the sources, all the versions, all the background in what is called a repository. And everybody can use that, and you can pick things from other ones. Even if you work on the same system, you can pick an enhancement from one person and pick another enhancement and a bug fix from a third person and build your own system. That's the principle of open source here. You can work fully disconnected. You don't have to have an internet connection to do your work, because all your work is done locally. Of course, if you want to distribute your changes to somebody else, you have to do some kind of internet connection. And it makes it very easy to handle contribution from other people. Taken for granted that you're working in small chunks. Don't make a huge change on 15 different source files and consider that one big change. The smaller work, the easier it is for you and the people you're contributing to. What I don't say is that working with GitHub is simple. There are a few terminology that you have to learn over time, and I still make, after 4 years working with Git, if I leave it around for, let's say, 6 weeks or 8 weeks, I have to rethink sometimes how was it? How was branching, cloning, going back again? But the tools like SourceTree, the visual interface on your PC for handling merges and pull requests and changes and commits, helps a lot to decrease the complexity. There's a difference between Git and GitHub. Git was originally created by Linus Torvalds, who developed the Linux kernel. And it's strictly command-based, like Linux people work. It's a very clever way of always having the latest version easily available and having older versions in another way around. GitHub is the web-based Git, what they call repository hosting service, a free website if you do free development open source. GitHub and users of GitHub is free. If you are a company, you can buy a commercial license on GitHub and it do all kinds of work for you. And when I made this presentation, April 2016, there were about 14 million users and 35 million repositories, source environments. And I assume it has been doubled since then, because it's more and more used worldwide as the website to help you manage Git repository. That doesn't mean that if you are working with Team Services from Microsoft, it also has a Git repository mechanism, so you don't need GitHub. But open source projects, most of them, store the information on GitHub, even including Microsoft, where the .NET framework is also stored on GitHub. So you can find all the parts of .NET there as well. I talked about 8 or 10 words. Repository, always sometimes called, already known as repo, fork, clone, stage, commit, push, pull, origin, upstream. Those 9 words, if you understand a little bit what those 9 words mean, I think you can handle and process yourself in working with Git and producing enhancement and contributions to other. I'm going to explain a number of them, and I'm going to make 2 situations available, one for yourself and one if you want to contribute to other people. Exercises, we discussed this. Questions so far? If so, I will answer them. That was the first part, 10 minutes. Okay, let's go to the second one. I take 3 parts. Yep. Let me see. Second part. GitHub for everybody who does some kind of managing source code over time. Not working together, but maybe for yourself in your single home office environment. Then you have to know about 4 different words: repository, commit, branch, and workflows. Okay, Git for a developer. What are the steps if you want, what do you need to do if you want to start with Git or GitHub? Those are the words that you have to know. First, you have to start a place where all your sources are stored. You have to create a repository. If you start working with GitHub, the original repository is on GitHub. There is your original final master file containing your end result. If you want to have a local copy, you clone this GitHub repository, this source file folder system, onto your PC. And if you start working and making changes, every small change is what I call a branch. You have the master line, and everything you change is a small branch on this particular original software. And unless you are satisfied, until the moment you're satisfied, this is the branch. And at a certain point in time, you commit the branch, and that means your final results are stored on your local system. If you want to bring it back to your central repository on GitHub, you do what they call a push. You put it over there as well. So you have 2 environments: the original repository source file environment on GitHub and your local copy that you do all the development with. Well, steps are easy. Go to GitHub, create a new repository, use your name, your own, you have an account, create a repository and a number of options in there if you start a GitHub repository. First of all, in your environment, it has to be a unique repository. You can specify if it is something for you only, or you can share with other people. Well, open source is public, this most of the time I share my repository. The first thing that the creation on GitHub will suggest you is to add a README file. README files are formatted in what they call Markdown format, MD format, which is something like HTML, but then different. It's a different type of scripting formatting language. And almost all repositories at least have a README file that tells a little bit of what kind of repository you have created over there. There's a special file in there, which is called gitignore, that helps Git to understand which files are important and which files are just temporary files or created files you can leave out from all the hassling around. you store extensions in there. You say, oh, this file is not important. My debug file is not important. You create the temporary files. My user files are not important. The only thing that are important are the ones that are not specified in here. And most of the time, especially if you're working in an open source environment, you specify the type of language that you have. Okay, let me create one for you. I will go to my repository environment on GitHub. Let me see if I have it somewhere. No, not really, but I can switch easily to it. Yep. Okay. Going to my environments, my profile. Yep. Please do. Okay. Over time, I've created a number of repositories for myself. And if I look at top of here, I think currently in my personal environment on GitHub, there are 32 different repositories. Some of them are copies of existing repositories. Some of them I've created myself. I will create a new one. It's as easy as this. I create a DNN connect EPT version. It's a public repository. I'll initialize it with a README file, and I specify I have an MIT license, which is the same open source license that all the DNN modules have. And that's about it. It will now create a repository. I see that I've made a typo over here, but please bear in mind that is okay. Cancel. Okay, that doesn't make a problem. And it now created the repository. Inserted a license file and inserted a README file automatic. And this is the content of the README file. If I go back to my repository or my repository list, you will see because I've entered a, let me see the repository list, one additional, 33. It has seen in my repository that I've created an MIT license. That's the reason why it can specify here MIT. If you're working with different type of source files, it can mention on this level also what type of source language you are using. So that's the first step, just create a repository. No, this one. Let's skip this one. And this was the demo. Okay, it's nice to have a repository on GitHub, but I want to work with it, so I have to copy this repository to my local machine. And this copying is called cloning. It doesn't just copy files, it copies a Git structure, the complete repository from GitHub, the website, into my local machine. Anything you want to clone, you can clone, and you get a complete copy of all the sources that are in this particular repository. I use most of the time source tree to do that for me, but you can also do a clone from GitHub, or you can do a clone using Visual Studio. So I start source tree. I have my repository still here. I'm going to look it up. Yep. Here's the button that is called clone or download. I'm just going to copy the URL because SourceTree needs this particular URL. This is the wrong one. SourceTree needs that URL to find this particular repository on GitHub in order to make a local copy, a local clone of my repository. Okay. File new. This is my source repository, and it's fine for me. I have my default development environment in D drive, develop, GitHub, and there it will copy it. This is the name of the repository, and it will completely copy the repository from the main environment. And if I do that, you will find that I have a complete copy of the repository that was on GitHub, now on my local machine in the folder GitHub something. And currently, I think there's almost nothing in. Yep. There's two files in, a file license and a file readme. That's what in there. And if I start my Explorer, I can go to the same folder as well. Okay, let me. Please come. Use another one. Dean and connect. Stripe here, connect here. You forgive me, my Norton Commander type interface. That's the way I'm used to. Long time, yes. I'm still getting much quicker with the interface than I can have with the Explorer. Sorry, I'm old. Used to habits. But I can find it here as well. GitHub. Yes, please open. Please open. Well. It doesn't want to. A little bit slow. Okay. Get the same files and they are, oh, left there. Okay. Try it again. Dean and connect. If I press the right buttons in here, you'll find the same files. A hidden folder Git that stores any information so Git knows what is where and what the status is and what the progress is. And the two text files, and those two text files are really text files. I can just edit it. Open with not Visual Studio, but I use my browser here. No, come on. And there is the text that is specified in the README file on the screen on GitHub. I'm going to correct that later on. So this is essentially making a local copy. And what has it done in this process? This part is GitHub. That's your original copy that you created and started with. This is your disk, your hard drive or anything. The clone does in step one or step two create a clone. You get an exact copy of the one on GitHub and it knows that these two belong together because on this repository is stored in the information file. There is an original version and this version is located here. And on this local version, you do your changes. And the changes are just editing the file, staging it, make a safe copy. And when you're finished and done and you're satisfied, you do a commit. Then the version is completely written into your local repository. And as long as you're working here, there's nothing wrong here. It stays the way it is. Edit, stage, save it, commit, write it down in the repository. The nice thing about edit, stage, commit is that all the older versions remain there. If it's a repository of 10 years back, you can find even the sources of 10 years back in there. So it doesn't matter if you make changes, commit, change, commit, change, commit, change, commit. If you're not satisfied, just go 5 steps back and start again with the original version. All the source versions are in there. They're not complete copies, but there's a clever way of storing only the difference between the different versions, but you don't recognize anything of it. If you want to go to back a previous version, just click on it and it will go back to you. And once you're satisfied with the result, you can say, okay, I have now a number of changes made and I'm going to put that back to the original copy that is on GitHub. The prerequisite is that you have to have the resources and the rights to write to this repository. There's a whole rule and write system in GitHub. For example, the way DNN uses it, you have the DNN platform original source. Anybody can clone that, copy that one. But if they want to make changes, they have to provide the changes to the team that controls all the changes back into the central system. So I shall give this a try to see if I can repeat all the steps that are in there. I am going to take my wrong text in here and I'm going to put something in there. This is a demo of my GitHub explanation. Okay, I save it. And if I now go back to my source tree, you will see that my source tree recognizes that something has been changed on disk. In this case, I have changed my README file. And it shows there, you have changes that you have made. It's not ready yet stored in the repository, but I see that there have been changes made. What do you want to do with it? Well, the most easy way is stage, put it apart, take for granted, and write it into the repository. If I want to, I can see on the right-hand side what has been changed. I've deleted some line, added some line, a new line, a text editor, so you can really see what the difference is between the existing one in the repository and the one that you have changed. I can say stage, and once I've done that, it writes these particular changes ready to be committed to the repository. And if I say commit, mostly you're asked to give some description. This is a better README. Commit. Okay, and that's it. So if I changed my file, I've working on the same original branch. I've done nothing. There's only one version around. And this is my master version on my local machine. Essentially, I've done not the right thing. I should have created a new branch, leave the master in place, and once we are satisfied, merge that one into the central system. But in this case, I'm the only one working. It's not that complicated yet, so I'm working on what they call the master branch. And if you look at the left-hand side, you will see that it's now master, and there is a one pointing upwards. And it tells something, you have changed something locally, and this change has not been carried forward into your GitHub central repository. It now enables also a push. If I press this on, it will merge my change that I've made locally, because I have the rights, full rights on my GitHub repository. It will push this change onto the central repository on GitHub for me. But all the different old versions are still around. If I click on this one and I select this one, you will see that it will be enabled to get the original files back there as well. So all the versions of all the source files are still there. How does this particular system know that there is a central version that is stored in what they call the settings in this repository? And because I started with a clone, it also stored internally the original version on GitHub. Was this version called this. And if I put there on edit, it knows, if I want to change it, it knows that it was the original URL that I've used from GitHub to create my local copy. So, if I push this one, I'm doing the last step. I'm taking the changes that I've made locally and satisfied and committed. I take these changes and merge them, push them into the central system. You can see the full output, what it does for command lines, and that's what I like about SourceTree. It hides all the different command lines for me. Completed successfully. Okay, let's check that. If I go to my central system, look into the code and do a refresh, you will see that my README file, which is this place here, contains the text that I've created and edited locally. And of course, you can change it here as well and see it here as well, because I'm the owner of this particular repo. Clone, make an original version, copy the one to my local file system, to my folder, doing some changing. That's the editing, whatever you want to do with editing, staging, committing it, and I push my changes back. And now those two are in sync again. Branching is a little bit more extensive, but not that much. It makes it easier, especially if we work in small chunks, to separate the different things going around. And most of the time they are using for a different type, for a bug fixing or for a work item enhancements or for creating features. You can do it online, the branching, but it's also very easy to use source tree to do the branching. And if you start with branching, most of the time there becomes a difference between the final master version that contains the final version of your project in a certain point in time and the line that you are developing upon. Okay. Well, let me give it a try. I'll go back to here. No, to source tree. Instead of continuing on this master line, I will create a branch. And the branch is for me called development. That's the normal thing I start with. And if it starts, it has the same thing as the master file. It's the same line at this point in time. But if I start enhancing and changing things, and I will create and edit my README file again. Save that one, put it away, and go back to here. You'll see again that source tree is recognizing that I've changed something and that I'm now working. That's the one that I've selected on the development branch. And most of the time you still keep on working on the development branch till you are finished with a particular release. And then you merge your development branch back into the master, so the master is again at the top line of your development. And this is the same trick here, stage, commit, more text, commit, and now I have a development branch going along. I can push that again. You see there is some kind of branching line available over there. And now there is a difference between the development branch and the master branch. And again, I can push it again to the central system and then it's ready for usage. I will commit this one, I've done, and I will push this branch also to my central system. And if I've done that, also on my central repository, I have two branches, the master branch, which most of the time I leave alone, and the development branch that I do all the changes with.
So in terms of the new version, so when you finish all your development, push it all to the master, we call that
right.
Say version one.
You're right.
If you want to create a new version, you create a new master or clone the master?
No, there's only one master. You start again with the development branch, because the development branch and the master are now merged, and you can start again with the development branch working aside your master. Your master is one point in time, and when you're finished with the next version, you pull the master again to the new development environment. So it's way around.
But if I want to go back to a previous version, for example?
If you want to go back to a previous version, it's just a matter of clicking here, and then your complete repository on your local disk is all the source file of that particular version minus 3 or something like that.
Okay, so I can swap between versions easily.
Yeah, because the repository contains all versions of all source file all in time when you started from the moment with GitHub. So it's very easy to come back to, let's say, version minus 4 from 3 years back, try to fix something. And even if merging works all right, sometimes you can even use this bug fix again in your new version, because it can merge this particular change that you've made from a source file from 3 years back. It is in the source file already 3 years. It's a small change, a quote or a double quote or whatever, and you can merge that in your new release that you're working upon. And that's the nice thing, because now I'm working parallel, but it can spread out a lot and you can pick things from one branch or the other branch into your central system. And that's the biggest benefit of working in small items. The smaller the items are, even if it's a typo correction, I make a new branch with this particular one typo correction, because if it's small, I can easily pick it up later and use it in other situations. Okay. Later on, if things are becoming a little bit more complicated, you can have multiple branches and multiple versions all over time. And for me, it helps this graphical interface, which is now very simple, but I can show you a little bit more elaborate graphical interface. For example, what I specified here, this is the mainline version 01, version 02, version 03. But people are also continuously developing on this particular different versions. Here they made a particular change, implemented in here, made some bug fixes in here, made some new announcements in here, picked that up and put that in version 0, version 1.0. So it's easy to get small items and later on pick the different items from different branches and put it in the central environment. If I go to source tree again and I pick up a little bit more elaborate repository that has been growing over the years. You see here a little bit more branching going around, because there are only very few people working on this. There's not so many branches parallel to each other, but if you're working with 5 people, you can have multiple branches in here. And here you can specify that I've specified a number of versions. I want to go back to this particular version, just to double click on this version. And my source repository locally is all the source files environment that was for this particular version. And sometimes I clean up some branches. If I've merged everything, I only at the end have a development and a master branch left, because all the bug fixes and the numbering is not interesting to me anymore. It's the final version. Okay. Four basic things: create a repository, make a local copy, create a branch, save your changes and push the changes back to your central system. That was part 2. I have one last part. Part number 4. 3. And what's part number 3? You're working with other people and your changes must be used in other source solutions. And essentially, is that not much different from the things that you have learned up until now? This difference is that you're not working this original copy for your source file. I have to create my own copy, do the change and enhancement, and later give my changes and improvements back to you. And the only place that this exchange can take place, if we work on different environments, is on GitHub. So if I want to improve your module is on GitHub, the first thing I have to do, I have to create my own copy on GitHub, because those two, GitHub and my disk, my environment, are the ones that are linked together. I cannot push anything into your system directly. And the way to give you my changes back is what they call pull requests. And if you look back, it's something like, I tell to you, I have a new change made, it's excellent, please take it over. And that's my pull, and you pull the changes from my GitHub repository and merge them in your central original copy. And there you have one additional word, essentially 2. The first word is fork. And the second word you have to learn is pull request. But the other three around clone stage, commit and push, stay the same. This is the original one. That's the way how you've been working. The contributing to others is a little bit different because you control this part and you control this part. So I cannot directly address your part. I have to make my own local copy. And if you look at big open source projects, there might be 10,000 or 30,000 different copies of this original repository from the project itself. I don't know how many there are for DNN platform, I think a couple of hundred. And that means that all the source files that you've created, because it's open source, I get in my repository, and from my repository copy, fork, what they call, because it's essentially a fork, I can do manipulations and this part. So there are essentially two steps to do the work. First of all, I have to make a copy of your repository. That's called a fork. We are still working on GitHub. And I do the rest. I clone this one on my local disk, do some editing, committing, and pushing it back to my local copy, my local copy back to my repository on GitHub. Not much more difficult, but essentially, I'm going to show you that one I've created on another environment on GitHub, not my selection of repository, but a central other type of system repository. I create it a new repository. It's a different one from somebody else. And because it's open source and it is public, anybody can copy this one. So I select this one. It's also a very simple one. And I can fork this one. So now I'm on GitHub. This is the original module from him, and I'm making my copy, my fork. I'm copying to my own private repository environment. And you see it from here. I had a access environment, and I created a local copy in my environment. And now I have a complete copy of what was originally in the environment here. And I can do the same trick. I can clone this one, and I will do it. Create a new repository on my local disk. Checking it. Yes, please do. And I'll have a second copy, one on GitHub and one on my local machine. Let me see if I can find this one. I can find, let me see, how was the name? This one, DNN Connect. I also made only a README file in there.
That's what you do if you wanted to work on the DNN, you fork it.
Yes, you always do a fork if you are not one of the core team members who is able to work directly. The normal way of working is that for a big project like that, nobody touches the original sources directly. All is done on a fork, all is done on changes, and in GitHub and DNN, all the changes that you supply to the original team is reviewed before being applied into the central system. And am I following, there are daily pull requests from different people, and people like Brian Dukes or Mitch Sellers or Cahal, or no, not Cahal, Vincenz, are reviewing the submissions of others. And sometimes there's a feedback to original developer, you haven't thought about this, I'm missing a unit test in there, or why did you do that? And some of the changes are incorporated, and there's a review process before it's implied, applied to the central system. Okay, and I'm going to change this one as well. This is from a central repo. Going to save that one, close that one, go to back to this environment. My master now has a changed README file, my local copy of the original one. I'll stage mine and I will commit my version. This is for the central system commit and push it. Some of the options are now stepping through, can be done in one step because you have some checkboxes you can put in there to make this readily available push. So what I've done, if this one is running, maybe we're here. What I've done, I make my copy on GitHub that is called fork, not copy, but fork. And now I have an original one. I cloned it locally, edited, staged, commit, and pushed it to my repository on GitHub, which was originally an exact copy of this one, but now there's an enhancement in this part. And I can see that if I go to here and look again into my part. Sorry? Okay. No problem. Yeah, okay. You see my enhancement that I've created in this particular text file, this text from a central repo. This is now in my copy. Namely, this copy. And now I have to tell something people here. Here I have a new change and enhancement. I think it's worthwhile for you to process this one because it contains a lot of useful information, bug fixes, text, whatever. And there you get, this is what we've done. Fork, clone, stage, commit, push. Now we have to go back. Those were the first steps. First of all, I have to tell my system that I can do it online, I can do it on the local source tree environment. We're going to skip that one, I do it on GitHub itself. I can say, in my version that now have I on GitHub, please take the changes and enhancements and pull that in the original repository. I can make a what they call a new pull request. This is my version with the enhancements in place. It knows that my forked version is linked to the original central version. It knows and specifies me that things have been changed in my files. It tells me, well, if you look at this particular repository on this branch, you have the same repository on the same branch, but you have made some enhancements, and those are the enhancements. Okay, I can create a pull request, and that means I have a new text file for you. This is signaling the manager of this original repository that things have been changed. It switches in this case, because I'm also a manager of this particular repository, to the original version. And now in my list of pull requests, this particular one that I've created is now available. This is my message that I sent to the central original repository manager, which is me in this case, which makes it a little bit difficult. It tells me, well, I can see that the text file, you can easily merge, there are no conflicts, there's only one person adding some lines in there. So it would be easy, if you want to, you can review, you can see which files have been changed in there. But in this case I say, okay, no conflicts with the base branch, merge the pull request, confirm merge, and now my original repository also has this new version around. And you can see it, this is the original version of the repository, and my text file is here as well. So, essentially what I've done, it create a pull request, what is called the upstream, the one further up the stream that was the original one. And what I most of the time do, I add this original version also in source tree as what is called an upstream. So source tree knows, oh, there are two original ones that my local copy originates from. There's your own original. And there's the one that was the father of the original, or the mother, or the ancestor of the original, whatever you call it. Okay, that's the simple case that I'm only contributing to the central system. But most of the time, hopefully, there are more people contributing to this original ancestor of the source file. And I have to cope with the changes that other people have done as well, because I want those changes in my local copy as well. Sadly enough, it doesn't do this way, because I cannot manage pull requests or pushes directly from here. What I want to do is to grab the new things from there, put it in my local repository, and push it to the one here. So in the end, these two are in sync as well. I can show you that as well, because now I'm not going to the central system, but I'm going to edit this file directly here. And because I'm the owner of the original version, I can edit it here as well.
Yeah.
I'm adding the original version because I'm the manager of the system, the highest up in rank, because I'm the owner of this particular repository, I have the rights enough, I can edit it directly in there, simulating changes that other people have supplied as pull requests to this original version. So it's called here, commit. Okay. And now you will see if I go back, this README file has been changed on the original version. I'm not aware of it because 15 people are working during the night bringing all these changes. I wake up in the morning at 5 o'clock. Has anybody done anything? But luckily enough, SourceTree can tell me that somebody has been working on this original version and changed things. And what I do in those cases, I say, please fetch me all the changes that all people have done over time since the last moment that I've reviewed my local clone. And it will look upon all the different masters that are in there and see that there are new things in there. No, because I forgot to mention that it has an upstream version as well. Let me copy this one, because it's only looking at my version currently. So. Yes, I do again the fetch. See what other people have been doing on the different forks, on the different central systems. And if you look at the full output, it's showing that it's querying all the different central versions that are there to see if there are new things around that are not ready in my local system. It's probably going to show me, hopefully, that my upstream repository, the original ancestor, has an updated file, and it specifies here that these are the lines that have been changed. I've edited here the text wrongly and added a new line and set to a new line. I want to have those changes into my system, and I'm going to pull from the upstream, the original ancestor, into my local system. And I'm going to take the master branch. So I'm taking all the changes into the ancestor original version and merging them into my local clone. Look at fetching, dean and connect, fast forwarding, readme file with some changes, one file traitor insertion, one deletion, completed. And you will see now that my local version is now also including this readme file, but my original fork is not yet up to date. So in this case, I push these changes coming from different people in my GitHub original version as well. So now the three are in sync again. And it seems complicated, and in this case, because we're only changing one file, one item, it's a little bit complicated, but if you have a lot of different changes, a lot of different branches from different people, sometimes you pick the changes from one and the other and the other and the other and make it into your system itself. And that's the case where things like unit testing becomes important, but at the end, you will want to verify that your system, your local version, is still doing all the work that you want to do and you haven't blown up anything in there. Oh, this one. So what we have done, there was a pull request over here. I've fetched these changes and I've taken a pull. I say, please give me, I pull from your central repository original ones and put them in my local system and then push them up again into my original version. Okay, so essentially it's not much more difficult to contribute to others. The first middle three things we have learned before: create a repository, clone, commit, push. So you keep your two versions in sync, that's all your version. If you want to do something for other people, fork, okay, create a copy online for the from their repository. Do these steps and later on create a pull request taking your GitHub version and your changes and say to the other one, please pull from my repository the changes that I've created for you. And that's the last part of this three line sessions. Ready? Those were the three things. GitHub for everyone, start working. GitHub for a developer, have all versions available, and contributing to others. These are more complex items in there, managing contribution from others, finding different things, merging going wrong, solving merges and so forth. And DNN platform is something else. Thank you.